I think most people right now are in a wait-and-see attitude, but it's not like that here. It's full blast, and the advances have just been stunning. I can't even hardly recount them all, what's going on right now. Huge, huge leaps forward, because the urgency is here. There's no holding back saying, well, let me wait and see. No. Got it. Know what's going on. And full steam ahead. Full steam ahead. Obstacles are being cleared out with incredible pace right now. Too much to go into. I don't even know where to start. It's so amazing. We live in the most interesting times ever. We live in the times of decision. We live in times of opportunity. It is the best of times, the worst of times, worst of times, best of times. It really is. It really is. We have the opportunity right now to sidestep the troubles that are to come. You see, if you understand what existence is all about, then it becomes very easy for you. Which is why Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of heaven and everything else will be added unto you. Meaning, seek first clarity. And then once you understand what's going on, then the details are easy to take care of. They're not difficult. We are trying to make fantasies real. What I call it, hypotheticals real. We cannot make hypotheticals real, but we're trying. And we have been trying for a long, long time, but there's no necessity to it. We don't have to keep trying. We really don't. And if we realize that we don't need to keep trying, that opens up freedom. It opens up the door. It opens up. Really does. So what's happening on this planet right now is there the aspects of spirit that want to keep trying to make fantasies real. And the prime fantasy we're trying to make real is death. We're trying to make it real, what, to mind, to spirit. We're trying to make it real so that then the fantasy of surviving death will also be real. You see, it's crazy. It is. But that's what we're trying to do. When you're faced with an impossible task, you end up using magic. Crazy magic. So, how do you make death real? How do you try to make death real? How do you make a fantasy real? By making it very intense, and by quantity, both quantity and quality. So, what is happening right now? There, those aspects of spirit that want to keep trying to make fantasies real, keep trying to make death real, have been planning for a long time to use this planet as a staging for a battleground. They want to use this planet as a battleground. They want to use it as a sacrificial killing ground, killing fields, as it were. They want this world to be full of death. They want a massive quantity of death here, of dying, of suffering, of trauma. That's what they want. And they want to have the quality of death, in other words, the intensity, the atrocity of death, to be extremely intense as well. So they want it to be very inhumane and savage. Also, both quantity and quality of the death there, they have set up the entire scenario where this comes to pass. So, on January 20th, about just before 12 noon, Eastern Standard Time, United States Eastern Standard Time, these aspects of spirit, call them whatever you want, initiated World War III, actually. This whole scenario of trying to make death real, at this point in time, it's called World War III. And the previous two were also attempts to make death real. But this one is way, 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 way beyond World War I or World War II. So it began. It began through a psychic attack on the planet by sending thought forms, very negative attack-based thought forms, flooding the world, flooding the subtle planes with those. And then from that psychic level, that gets into our minds. Our minds are receivers, very, very subtle, very finely tuned. Our brain can receive these psychic messages, and they can slip into our unconscious very easily. And then we think that it's coming from us, or it's not. And these thought forms are meant to impulse us into war, into attack, into violence, into death. It's already started, and I realized it right off the bat. And I said, okay, full blast now, and the plan to sidestep all of this, which is what I've been talking about, trying to talk about my whole life. I said, this is coming, and there's a way to sidestep it. Very simple. There's no difficulty in that at all. What do you do when there's a very bad, for instance, in World War II, before World War II happened, what did those who were wise enough in Germany, for instance, to get out of Germany, did so, didn't they? What did they do? They sidestepped the problem. A lot of Jews sidestepped the Holocaust, in other words, because they said, hey, we can see what's coming. Let's get out of the way. That's just being smart. Okay, you're supposed to be very smart in this world. You're supposed to be. And yet we've made it cool to be dumb, which is why I call the dumbing down of the planet. It had to happen because the aspects of spirit that are trying to make death real, they don't want anyone to escape. They want everyone to die. They want the death to be total, make it real total. They're not trying to help anyone do sidestep it. They're not. So how do you do that? You dumb everybody down. You make being dumb cool. It's called cool. What you do, you have a bunch of celebrities modeling dumbness, and they're up there on the big screen, and we look up at the big screen and goes, oh, that's really cool. I wish I could be up on the big screen. Look, everybody's watching this figure up there on the big screen, on the television. So that's really cool, isn't it? This technology's kind of cool. See, but they use technology to dumb us down. So now most of the world is very dumb, which is not a good thing at all, because you got to be very smart here. You got to be very, very smart. I'm one of those who was aware of the whole situation, and I worked night and day to remain very, very smart. It wasn't easy to avoid getting dumbed down. It was extraordinarily difficult to avoid it. So I know not many have avoided it, but some have. Some have. And kudos to all of you who are still very, very, very. So you say, hey, yeah, sidestepping World War III, that'd be a really good thing to do. Just be the smart thing to do. So of course I'm working on this night and day, how to sidestep it for a long, long time. Knowing that it's coming, I got a tremendous amount of warnings ahead of time. So there's a slight delay on this audio with my mouth. Interesting. There is a way to sidestep it, and that is what is coming to light now. There is a way to sidestep it, but you have to understand that fantasy is just fantasy. Anything's possible in fantasy, except that the fantasy be real. That's impossible. So there's going to be a fantasy war here in a fantasy world, and we're going to sidestep it in a fantasy way. The difference is in accepting a fantasy that's not trying to make itself real. You know it's a fantasy, but there's a thing to prevent it from being a beautiful fantasy, because it's not trying to become real. See, it's not trying to fool you or deceive you in any way. It's just saying, here's a totally beautiful fantasy that reflects reality. That's called using the hypothetical, the happy hypothetical, using it in the right way. So you could say we're going to go to a fantasy world, totally, totally beautiful, stunningly beautiful world, immaculate world. Of course it's a fantasy. It's still a hypothetical. Still a hypothetical. But it's not trying to become real. It knows its purpose is to reflect reality, to remind us of reality. It knows that's what its purpose is. So it's completely easy if you understand that all of this fantasy of existence is just imaginary. There's nothing at all preventing you from imagining a scenario that reminds us of reality. And there's nothing in the way, stands in the way from us being transported to such a scenario. Absolutely nothing standing in the way, actually. It's just we've been so dumbed down, we don't even think about this stuff. As I said, you have to be really smart here in this world. Really smart. And you cannot allow yourself to be dumbed down, which this world does a very good job of dumbing everyone down. Because we're thinking that we're supposed to get enthralled by death here, and by getting enthralled by it, we're making it real. We're helping make it real. How can you help make a fantasy real? You can't. It's a waste of time. So I pretty much just dismissed all that stuff. Just examined it, I observed it, and I just said, this is all nonsense. And then right use of time. What do the really smart do? Make right use of time. That's what they do. Make right use of time. And they dismiss the fantasy of death. They dismiss the attempt to make death real. They say, this is all just a fantasy. And does this fantasy remind me of reality? No. So it's useless to me. Completely useless. Completely useless. Hypotheticals are totally useless unless you use them to remind you of reality. And the nature of reality, having got a glimpse of it myself, I know what will remind us of reality and what doesn't. See, that's another thing, being very smart. You say, hey, I know what reality is like, so therefore I'm able to see, does this remind me of reality? He said, no, it does not. It does not. Death doesn't. Fantasies of death don't remind us of reality. Fantasies of impermanence, fantasies of threat, fantasies of vulnerability, fantasies of change, all that stuff, it doesn't remind us of reality. A fantasy of immaculate beauty that doesn't change, that it can't be threatened, that is always beautifully, exquisitely what is, that does remind us of reality. Now, if you want to talk about this whole spiritual plumage in the world, there's so much spirituality in the world that is just a fashion show. Honest to God, it's just a fashion show. When I look at most of the spirituality that's taking place right now, it's simply a spiritual fashion show. That's all that it is. There's no real keen intelligence there. It's just they're having us, you know, fashion show. Let's show off how spiritual we are. Let's talk about how much we love each other and all this kind of stuff. The purpose of hypotheticals is remind us of reality. That's the only purpose they can ever have. The best way that I've ever seen to remind ourselves of reality is to look upon something that is so beautiful, you're surrounded by beauty, so beautiful you don't have any desire to change it. Now what happens is, when you talk about sharing minds being willing to be one, share a common experience, etc. The best way to do that is to sit and look upon exquisite beauty, being surrounded by exquisite beauty, because you know both of you are having the same experience. You're sharing the experience. You don't have to say anything, as a matter of fact. The whole idea of talking about, oh, I love you, you're so wonderful, aren't you nice, and all this stuff. If you're both sitting there watching this exquisitely beautiful situation, you know exactly what the other one is thinking or experiencing. And they know what you're thinking and experiencing. You don't need any words. The communion is there. You know you're both communing with this beauty. There's no doubt about it. And you just look at each other and smile. And there's no problem with the communication. There's communion taking place. You're sharing the experience. Doesn't need words at all. That is the best way. By far and away. You don't need to say anything. You don't need to say, oh, I'm going to love you. I love you forever. I love you so much. What do you need to say? You don't need to say anything because you know your friend is having the same experience you're having. And it's reminding them of reality just as it's reminding you of reality. So you're having you have a common understanding. And you accept it. You both accept it. Say, ah, we know that we're accepting this. And this is what it's all about. Now, when people use drugs, they try to get that. The pot smokers are in a circle and they're all smoking pot. And then afterwards, all kind of just look at each other and smiling. Because they say, hey, we all know. We're sharing this experience of being high together. They're trying to mimic this principle. And they say, they don't need to say anything because they just know, wow, we're both kind of seeing things differently than before, right? But that's what they're doing. That's what they're trying to do. So there's some kind of powerful pull to that, to people like this. Let's get drunk together. Let us do something, get high together, that kind of thing. They're trying to have communion, a shared experience like that, and have minds be one. In fact, there's no part to minds, but just allow mind to see, to be mind, instead of trying to make fantasies real. Just let mind be mind. And but if there are two who are simply viewing exquisitely beautiful surroundings, and the surroundings will always be that way, flawless, everything's flawless, I call it the real world, the death-free realm, then you're sharing a remembrance of reality. And that really heals the mind. The mind says, I know what I am all about here is remembrance of reality. So getting to the death-free realm is all important. If you want to be saved, that's the way to be saved. That's the quick way to be saved. These spiritual fashion shows, Let's examine every thought. Okay, here's a thought. Let's examine every feeling. Let's examine every sensation. Now, did you, when you said that, did you mean this? Blah, 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 blah. Desperately trying to, let's get a thought that we can think, both all think together. Let's think, okay, peace. Let's all think loving thoughts. What about being really smart and saying, let's just dwell in the death-free realm where everything is perfectly exquisite and you don't want to change a thing. And everything reminds you of reality. And everybody there will be having the same experience. They don't need to talk at all. And you just smile. You just smile. It's just like, wow. You know that everybody's having the same great experience you are. Nobody's left out. You don't need to say anything. Because you know we are loved forever. You will know we are loved. You don't say, I love you forever. You say, we are all loved forever. And you're being reminded of this because everything you see is being loved forever. It's a fantasy of eternal love. It's a fantasy of not needing hypotheticals. It's a hypothetical of the non-necessity of all hypotheticals. And this is, it's a reminder of everyone. You see, this is here forever for everyone, as it were. As long as hypotheticals last, as long as we have a need to remember reality, this fantasy will last. And people just be very, very quiet. I've experienced this, actually, in various ways. Not the death-free realm, but I've experienced sitting in an exquisitely beautiful place with people. There are some places that are more beautiful than others, and I had the opportunity to spend time in one of these places, several places actually, and people just sat. They just come and go, and there was all this seating, and I just sat there, like just quietly like this, and just observed, just soaked in the beauty. Didn't say anything. If you see someone, you might smile. They kind of nod and smile at you because they know what you're there for. You know what they're there for. Everybody knows. They know. Okay, this is what we came here for. We came to absorb this beauty, just dwell in this, abide in this beauty. You're on the same page, automatically on the same page. You don't need to make declarations. You don't need to examine your thoughts, structures, or your psychology, or any of that stuff. That stuff is just a spiritual fashion show. It's a waste. It's not right. It's not a right use. It's not the best use of time. There's lots and lots and lots of spiritual fashion shows that could be put on. That's not the best use of time at all. Not at all. So what I've been looking towards is getting to the death-free realm, because that seals the deal for sure. For sure. Yeah, you can do it in other ways that take a long time and a lot of effort and are very problematical and all this stuff. You get to the death-free realm and it's for sure you're going to remember reality and drop hypotheticals at some point altogether. There's no question. It's the safe way. It's the smart way. So, of course I'm focused on that. How to do that? Focused on transport. How do you get transported from this world to the death-free realm? So, of course, imaginary transport. Yes, this is the imaginary world. The death-free realm is also imaginary world. So what do you use? You use imaginary transport. So how difficult can that really be? Can it really be difficult? It's like you're in a dream and you're being chased, and someone chased you. This monster chased you to the ocean's shore or the big river, and you're stuck on the riverbank, and you look, and here comes the here comes the monster with swords ready to cut you to pieces, and you look at the river and you say, I can't swim, I don't know what I'm going to do, you know, I'm stuck. And then you suddenly imagine that there's a boat, a power boat shows up, someone grabs you and goes, get in, you jump in the power boat and zoom, go across the river, and they let you out on the other side and say, oh my gosh, I survived, unbelievable, it's incredible. How could that power boat show up right then? Grace of God, it's amazing. No, you just dreamed it. You just dreamed the powerboat showing up because you wanted it. And you felt, I really want a boat to show up right now. And boom, there's the boat. So if we really want to go to the death-free realms, if we really want to dwell there and really share the communion of that experience with everyone that goes there, We just simply say we really want to go there. And how do we get there? The transport shows up. Just like that. It's the power of our decision drives dreams. We're the one dreaming this whole dream. So of course we can dream. A dream transport shows up. Just at the right time, transport will show up. How could it be otherwise? It's imaginary, and we're the ones doing all the imagining. So there's not like some other party doing the imagining that can interfere with it. We're doing all this imagining. Everything. All hypotheticals. We are the ones who are doing the imagining. God is not doing the imagining of hypotheticals. We are. Spirit is. God's doing the sustaining of creation. It's not involved with hypotheticals. Reality is totally real. Reality is not involved with hypotheticals. It's only when we want to be prime creator and dictate to reality the way it needs to be, dictate to God the way that God needs to be, and set our own rules and make our own creation of it all. That's when we dwell in hypotheticals. That's when we need hypotheticals. We feel a necessity for hypotheticals. So, it's time. I've been pushing for years and years and years, urgently, with total urgency, saying, don't wait, get it now. Get this information now. Don't wait. If you wait, it's too late, period. Though those who've waited, it's going to be too late for them because they have not even got familiar with this or considered it or anything. So you have to consider it ahead of time, of course. Because when World War III comes upon you, and it'll come upon you like an avalanche, like a rock slide, you will have to know how to sidestep that already. You already have to make the decision. You've already made the decision. Okay, I'm going to sidestep this. I know there'll be a way. I know there's a place and a way, and it's the right thing to do. That's simple. Then at that point, it's doable. Whereas if you never consider it ahead of time, you'll be so inundated by the problems, you'll just be flustered and flounder around. So, it's no good to send warnings into the world if nobody listens to them. People say, well, when something happens, then we'll listen to you. That's being stupid. So, what I encountered in this world, which was very unfortunate, is the dumbing down of the world. The world got profoundly dumbed down. It used to be that people kind of, when I was young, they sort of listened and said, well, you got something to say, you know, and then they said, well, you know, maybe I'm smart enough to get this, but as things got dumbed down more and more and more, the people would just say, no, they got no interest. They say, I can't be that smart, that's impossible, or that must be great, you're crazy, what is that, that's off the charts, I don't even know what that is, it must be craziness or something. See, being really smart means right use of time. That's what it means. There's no other meaning. Why? How could that have any other meaning? It'd be useless if you don't use time right. How can you be smart? It's impossible. You can't be smart if you don't use time right in hypotheticals. In hypotheticals, being really smart means using your time very wisely. That's it. If you don't use your time wisely, you're being dumbed down. You've been dumbed down. And of course, this whole planet now is geared to dumbing everybody down severely, turning us all into very, very, very dumb people. And it's very dumb to think you're a person in the first place. But the dumbing down has gone on to such a huge extent that most people have not prepared. And they're not ready. That's a fact. And it has nothing to do with my lack of effort at all. I've given full out effort my whole life. I cannot feel guilty about lack of success because people have been too dumbed down. I was part of the plan, part of the attack, part of the attempt to make death real is to dumb down the planet. And those involved did a great job at that. They're very, very talented at dumbing down planets. Super talented. Which is why we had teachings, spiritual religious teaching in this world to keep us from being dumbed down too much. And get some resistance to that. Because, again, these folks who want to try to make the fantasy of death real are very expert at dumbing down planets. They know how to do it. And they certainly did it. And I observed them how they did it. And I said, I said, hey, people, don't pay attention to this. You're being dumbed down. Don't watch television. You're being dumbed down. Movies, television, pop songs, music, popular culture, news, all that stuff, and education, et cetera, et cetera, is specifically been used to dumb you down, to dumb the planet down. All of it. Very, very, that's the intent. Super intent there, to dumb us down. So the really smart ones avoid that stuff. Avoid it. I had to avoid that stuff for the most part. I examined it. I went through periods of examination. And so then I discarded it. It helped me discard it. Kind of look at it and you say, is this worth anything? And then you say, no, it's not. So I did go through periods of examination of all sorts of stuff. The stuff that's being used to dumb us down, I examined it all. I said, is this really smart or not? And said, no, it's not really smart. Let me set this down. Okay, that's it. Finished with it. Finished. Really, I mean, I haven't watched a movie in, I don't know, 20 years, 30 years, I don't know how long has it been, really. Maybe 25 years, I haven't watched, I don't think I've watched a single movie. And because I realize, hey, this is being used to dumb us down, stupid, I don't want to be stupid. That's, being stupid is dangerous, it's threatening. Really, if you allow yourself to be dumbed down and you don't use your time wisely, you're really committing suicide. You're headed in a suicidal direction, really. Because then you will not be able to sidestep World War III, which is really just a term to say an intense all-out effort to make death real, which means they need both quantity and quality. Deaths of all kinds. They want death of all varieties. They want people to die from so many different things right now. In huge, huge quantities. And you name it. They're going to come up with. They probably have millions and millions of ways to die, on their computers, and trying to make sure that there's all type varieties of death, all intensities of death, all quantities, everything. The whole shebang is what they're really looking for. So. It's stupid not to sidestep that because again. Death can't be made real. This is all a total waste of time. It's all for naught. All for nothing. And that's stupid. Why involve yourself in something that is all for naught? How can you justify it? It's just some kind of crazy whim. It's beyond stupid. It's a crazy whim. It's an extravagant whim. And if you want to continue to be very, very extravagant, you just go along with that. But In hypotheticals, we cannot afford to be extravagant like that. Because, again, it gets us nowhere. Except more of the same, more of the same. We don't want more of the same. We want to get free. So, the global challenge that I started on the 19th of February, January, 19th of January, just before the inauguration on the 20th of January, I'm going to reword it a little bit. I'm going to say Global Challenge 213, 216, right use of time. What is the right use of time? What is right use of time? And I want everybody to meditate on that. It's the key, right use of time. What is the right use of time? The right use of time right now is to focus on sidestepping World War III. That's the right use of time. So we ask ourselves every day, what is the right use of time? And you can do that. That's a meditation you can do all day. Is the best meditation now. All day you say, whatever thought comes to you, say, is this the right use of time? And you start thinking about someone else and the little petty dramas of the world. You say, wait a minute, is that the right use of my time? I accepted this global challenge, this challenge. Clarity Ross's global challenge for everybody on the globe, meaning everybody's for everybody. What's the right use of time? Is this the right use of time? Is what I'm doing the right use of time? That stops you. It's a great meditation. It's an active meditation. You're going along, you're driving, you're listening to the radio, and you say, whoa, wait a minute, is this the right use of time, listening to the radio here? You're humming a song, kind of blanked out, humming a song. So wait a minute, whoa, 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 is that the right use of time? Your thoughts start wandering, is that the right use of time? What's the right use of time? And then you start getting into, hey, how can I sidestep, and what would it be like? What would it be like to sidestep the troubles that are coming in this world? What would that be like? And you say, oh, that feels like that's the right use of time, really. That's how I want to use my time. So active meditation is the best meditation, because you do it you can do it constantly during the daytime. You don't have to have a period set aside where you're just quiet and like this. You can do it while you're working, while you're doing everything. Talking to someone on the phone, you suddenly say, wait, is this my right use of time? And say, wait a minute, not really. Okay, hey, I gotta go. Boom, that's it. Cut it off like that. What I've found is in using this for the last couple days is I've been making decisions I never made before. Cutting stuff short that I never cut short before. Just saying, not now, no. Saying no, I'm saying not now to people. Whereas before I'd indulge them, I'd humor them. Say no, not now. It's not right, not right use of time. Not the best use of time at all. Right use is meaning focused on what is truly useful. What is true. Staying in this world is not useful, because you're just going to die. And that's not useful, actually. Death is not useful, because it doesn't remind us of reality. There's no death in reality. There's no threat in reality. There's no harm. So death does not remind us of reality, so it's useless. So spending your time on what is useless is not right use of time. So I had a dream several nights ago, maybe three or four nights ago. I was in this transport, some kind of transport ship, which was interstellar and which could go back and forth in time. And it wasn't like the spaceships that with UFOs we see or stuff like that. No. It was really not really great. It was like a great vehicle. I was like, wow. And I was driving it. I was piloting this transport vehicle. And I was getting used to piloting it and going back and forth. And you could go to a star system like that. You could go to places, hyperdimensional transport vehicle. Seemed like I was piloting it. So maybe I'm going to be a pilot, one of the transport pilots. That's possible. Or maybe each one of us needs to learn how to pilot transport vehicles. Possible too. Very possible. When you're really advanced, you don't even need any transport vehicle at all. You just instantly can show up anywhere. But we're not there yet. Someday we will be sometime. But right now, we might, in our imaginations, this is all a fantasy anyway, we might as well say, hey, I'm going to dream up a really cool transport vehicle to take me. And one will show up, absolutely. So I don't really know if it's like big transport vehicles where there's pilots and the pilots take a lot of people, or just each one of us has our own one. I'm not really sure. That needs clarification. That's right use of time. Clarifying this stuff is right use of time. So I focus on that as they think. And most people will say, what a waste of time. That's not crazy use of time. Yeah, wait until World War III really gets down to the physical plane. Then they'll sing a different tune and it'll be too late for most of them. They'll say, wait a minute, how do I get out of there? What do I do? And they'll be so flustered that they won't be able to calmly figure it all out. Yeah, no, there's a time to figure stuff all out, and there's a time for action. And you better have it figured out before the time for action comes. It's possible like people say, well, we're so uncertain about this, or we want to go, but we're kind of, you know, like a little bit, we don't quite have it figured out, but we want to be transported there, but we don't feel like we're capable of transporting ourselves there. So then they would need like a transport vehicle with someone piloting the vehicle, to like an airplane, and a pilot in the airplane taking passengers somewhere, that in their imagination, that's what they would want. That is possible. So it's possible that I could be far enough along that I could actually fulfill the role of piloting a transport vehicle. That is possible. Either way, with me, either being transported by someone else piloting it, or being a pilot, it doesn't really matter to me. I was just thinking about that today. It's interesting to note that my dad was a pilot in World War II, and he was an ace pilot, actually. And he was so good, he was chosen to fly in MacArthur's honor guard into Tokyo to sign the Articles of Surrender in Tokyo. The battleship Missouri or something like that. And so he was one, I think there's like 20 pilots chosen to fly MacArthur's honor guard. And he was one of those pilots. He was an ace pilot. Flew huge transport ships, actually. Airplanes. Huge transport airplanes. C-something. I don't know, was it C-140s or something? C-4. They're the ones that carried the troops and the heavy equipment. So he flew over the hump in Burma, over to, into China, because Burma was occupied by the Japanese. So he flew that route, flying heavy equipment and troops. Also in the island theater, flew out of Clark Air Force Base in Subic Bay, I believe, in the Philippines. He transported large amounts of troops and equipment all over the whole, you know, the Eastern Pacific War theater, and was incredibly talented pilot. But for me, I've never had any desire to be a pilot. Well, because my eyes are so terrible, I'm almost blind. How can I fly a plane? That's just like, no way in the world could I ever fly a plane. But, see, these transport vehicles are flown by spiritual clarity and will. Spiritual will and spiritual clarity. And I do have that. If spiritual clarity were eyesight, my eyes would be better than 20/20. So from that standpoint, maybe I have really good eyesight. And from the standpoint of other people being afraid to pilot, maybe they say, oh my gosh, my eyes aren't good enough. My spiritual clarity isn't good enough. Just like I say, if someone were asked me to pilot an actual airplane in this world, I'd say, impossible, cannot do it. My eyes are not good enough. No way can I do that. The same kind of feeling if people were asked to transport a transport vehicle, interdimensional transport vehicle, they would say, oh, we can't do it, our clarity's not good enough. We'd freak out. But for me, I believe I could do it. I don't see why not. I don't seem to be freaked out by the notion of it. I'd say, hey, okay, you want to train? Let's go. Let's go. Let's do it. Not a problem. Because the intent to get there is very strong. I understand what it's all about. So I believe I could be an easy learner. Very easily learn to do that. So maybe that most people feel they don't have the clarity to do to pilot it, but they want to be transported there in some way. So that it'll play out in that way. I would think so. This is what's called the rapture, actually, in Christian theology and eschatology, talking about the end times, is the rapture. We're in the tribulation period already. It began January 20th. It began. The real tribulation period began. We're already into it now. So the rapture is going to happen also. And the rapture is what I call the sidestepping of the battlefield here. The sidestepping the whole situation. And shifting into the death-free, problem-free, exquisitely beautiful realm where communion is everless. Where we all are automatically on the same page. Now, it may be that not everybody wants to quite go that high, and there may be intermediate places, actually. Just like on a flight where you're going to some location in the world, the plane may stop several places along the way, and passengers may get off in those places. So, maybe not everybody is going to go to the death-free realm, the realm, the hypothetical, the non-necessity of trying to make death real, that realm. Maybe they'll stop off at realms where there's less intensity of necessity, and so it is not such a battleground. That's possible. That's fine, too. So in transporting, there could be several stops along the way. And I can just fly the route, fly the hump over Burma, as it were. The battlefield, the terrible battlefield there, my gosh. Yeah, I mean, war is hell. Nobody knows that better than combatants. And, of course, my parents' generation was World War II, and then a lot of people just a little bit older than me was Vietnam. and you talk to the vets, and you know, they'll tell you what it's about. It's terrible. And a lot of the death in war is through ancillary things like sickness, all sorts of illnesses. You get hit by all sorts of stuff, all sorts of infections, all sorts of illnesses, all sorts of ailments from biological agents, inhaling stuff, all sorts of mental illnesses from battle fatigue. You get battle fatigue, you get post-traumatic stress syndrome or stress syndrome on the battlefield, all sorts of terrible stuff. You're shell shock, and of course also then you get, it goes on and on and on and on. You die in so many different ways. You see other people die in so many different ways. You're enmeshed. You're abiding in death. At least the fantasy of death. Who wants to do that? I don't even want to look at car accidents when I pass them by. I've never had an interest in death. I always would get the shudders from it. I just hate it. I don't want to look upon it at all. Never want to look upon death at all. And just like, God, horrible. I don't like pain. I don't like suffering. I don't like anything like that. I want to just see a perfect world. So the notion of staying here in this world does not interest me at all. Now, I talked about in a previous video about some of the tricks that these aspects of spirit who want to try make the fantasy of death real have employed to try to trap us here, to try to keep us here. They want everybody to die or witness death, one or the other. Of course, the survivors here will have witnessed an unbelievable amount of carnage. Of course they will. They'll have witnessed a world being torn to pieces. So even if they survive, they'll be in a state of just utter trauma, shock from all the carnage. So they want everyone to stay here, because that's their plan. Let's make death real. They don't want anyone to leave. They don't want anyone to leave. So in a case like myself, they couldn't convince me not to leave by threatening me, by intimidation, by all this stuff. So they tried a very clever tactic. The ego will tell any lie at all. It doesn't say, well, there's some lies that it won't use. No, it'll utilize any lie at all. Whatever lie seems to work, it'll use it. That's what it does. It functions through lying. So a very clever deception was utilized in my case to try and trap me here. And temporarily, it was effective. And gradually, I was able to see through it. Until the fact is, this morning, I believe it was this morning or it was last night, but in the last 24 hours, I suddenly saw through it entirely. I said, wow, and made a decision. No way. What it was I was told psychically, telepathically, I was told that Anandamaya Ma was coming back, was reincarnating in the world. And I was shown who she was and all this stuff. First, I was shown who she was. And then I realized, oh my gosh, this is like the best example of the death-free world I've ever seen. Really, because she really was. Unsurpassed example of the death-free world and how you feel there, the bliss you feel there. Absolutely amazing. And then I was told, yeah, and she's coming back. And you don't want to miss it. And then I said, and then I was told, you know what? You're going to play a key role in helping bring her to the whole world, this reincarnation. And everybody can help save so many people here. And I said, wow, really? That's incredible. So I fed this story. You know that guy, that football player from Notre Dame, thought he had a relationship with his girlfriend at Stanford. And it was really that she never existed. It was a hoax being perpetrated on him. Yet he was sucked in like that. It's like that. That's the kind of hoax that's played in this world. These aspects of spirit want us to witness the carnage here. They want us to stay here. They will tell us tall tales to us. So the tall tale that was told to me was that Sri Anandamaya Ma is reincarnating in the world, and that I'm going to be one of her entourage, and I'm going to help introduce her to the world and get everybody feel that bliss, and that'll be like a totally great spiritual revival in the world. And there's going to be, I was told there's going to be a huge spiritual revival in the world, and it's going to save save so many people. You can't even believe how many people you're going to save by doing that. And I actually was telepathically given, like, the mind in its fantasy is able to imagine imitations. You know, like those people are really adept at mimics. So what I was shown, at least partially, I believe I was actually contacted Srinath, my mom, the real one too. But what the ego did was it tried to provide a fake Ananda my ma contacting me. So I thought, maybe this is her, and telling me, yes, I'm coming back, and this is what you need to do, and had me do all this stuff. And I thought that she was coming back, but everything that I was promised had happened. None of it ever happened. And I was left just like feeling like, what's going on? She never showed up. I was left at the altar 1,000 times, literally. I was told that she's going to be here, and you got to be all ready. I had everything ready. I went into severe debt. Get everything ready. She never showed up. As I said, what happened, you see? It's taken me a long time to figure it out. But you have to understand, the power of imagination is capable of projecting mental imagery like a movie into your mind, and mimicking teachers, mimicking people, whoever wants to mimic. It pretends that and you think you're getting you're actually witnessing like the true teacher, where it's not. It's actually not. And then they can concoct this tall tale about they're coming back, they're reincarnating, and you have a crucial role. So basically, I felt like I couldn't leave this world. How could I leave this world if I had a super crucial role here in this world to help save, you know, millions of people, and I had the opportunity to participate in that? So you see how that would bind me to the world. I wouldn't leave. So it's a very clever strategy that was used by the ego. And anybody could be duped by that, because the mimicking of Ananda my ma was incredible. How they were able to mimic her and then psychically talk to me as if that were her, and say, you need to do this, you need to do this and this and this, and all this guidance. I was able to do everything requested of me, but she never showed up. And so I knew, so there's something bogus about this. There's something deceptive. This is not right. So gradually I had to gain enough spiritual wisdom to see through this clever ruse that was used. It's the same ruse that was used to say Jesus is returning. The same thing. Exact same type of thing. That everyone says, no, Jesus is returning. We're just waiting for him to come back. Waiting. Where are you waiting? You're waiting on the battlefield. Okay. Same kind of trick. And the dark ones are they employ this trick to trick the spiritually minded people of the world to wait here. Because they think that if they can convince the spiritual-minded people of the world, the really smart ones, that death is real, that all this carnage is real, then that will go a long ways to making it real, actually. So they'll employ the highest kind of trickery, the most subtle, cleverest kind of trickery on those who are very, very smart here to convince them to stay here too. So the fact is that I'm not going to stay here. I don't care if she and I am on my mind is reincarnating, or Jesus Christ is reincarnating or returning. Doesn't make any difference to me now at this point, because going to the death-free realm is infinitely more useful than staying on the battleground, even if Sri Anandamayi Ma was on the battleground herself, or Jesus Christ was there on the battleground himself. That's nice, but it's infinitely more useful to go to the death-free realm. And again, the only function of hypotheticals is to be useful. So the being really smart, you say, what is most useful? That's the only criteria. What is most useful? And this whole tale can be twisted in various different ways, and I look at it various different ways. Oh, you can be helpful here. The real help is getting people transported to the death-free realms, or at least off of the battleground here. That's the real help. So anything that's not that is not really useful. Now, if there's Jesus wants to help in that, fine. Great, let's do it. But I'm not going to stay on the battleground waiting for Jesus to show up. That's a trick. That is a big-time trick. And a lot of Christians have been tricked by that. A lot. I wasn't tricked by that, but Sri Anandamayi was, we had videos of her and stuff, and you see how she's like, yeah, and you say, wow, I want to see what that's like. That'd be really cool to be around when she's here. That'd be great. That'd be really neat. But in looking at this for many, many years, I said, well, it's nothing compared to actually going to a death-free realm. Not at all. It's just kind of like hanging out with a spiritual celebrity, but what use is that? On a battleground, it's minimally useful, actually. It's good for preparation, yeah. It's really good for preparation if you want to prepare to leave this world, to sidestep it. It's great for that. But once the conflict starts, the only issue is transport out of here. You don't want to be hanging around with some guru here. That's stupid. You're trying to be like a superstar by doing that. It's pride that does that. You say, well, I can handle all this carnage. You know, I remember when the Holy Spirit told me, stop watching television. I said, no, I can handle it. The Holy Spirit says, no, you can't. Just says, defer to my advice on this one. It's very important. And I said, okay, I'll defer to you. A crucial decision in my life. Because I fought it, I said, no, I'm smart enough. I can handle this. I know how to deal with this stuff. And the Holy Spirit said, no, you don't. He said, yeah, you're really smart, but not smart enough. You don't know who you're up against. So, defer, please defer. I was asked to defer, and I said, okay, I'll defer. You got it. And I stopped, and that was crucial. The Holy Spirit said I'd never be ready in time if I didn't defer. And I deferred, and I'm ready in time. So there again, Holy Spirit's right. Right advice, right use of time. Right, intelligent deference, right there. Perfect example. So those who want to stay in the world is trying to show off. This is being the spiritual show-offs. It's stupid. Stupid. Wrong use of time. Stupid use of time. Because the alternative is you could go to the death-free realm where you wouldn't need to show off at all. You would remember reality. Who are you showing off to? I mean, if you stay in this world, who are you showing off to? Anyone that's really smart? No? Well then, what is the big deal if you show off the people are really dumb? What's the feeling? You know, who cares? Who cares? Not impressing anyone. You're not impressing intelligence. You're impressing dumbness. What use is it to impress dumbness? There's no use at all. So forget about showing off. Forget about saying, well, I can handle the carnage here. See, I can handle the carnage here. I'm really spiritual. I'm really pure. I've got Jesus, I got Sri Anandamayi, I got Ramana Maharshi, I got this and that. Now I can handle it. I'll just stay standard. I'll stay centered. Again, the Holy Spirit would speak to me and say, hey, defer to my advice on this one. You don't know what you're up against. It's very stupid. You won't be able to handle it. Go to the death-free realm. Work on being transported to the death-free realm. Or realms that are not so intensely focused on trying to make death real right now. I would suppose there are such places where there is a less intensity, less desire to make death real. Right now on this planet there's an intense desire to make death real, which is why it's the battleground, which is why there's a need to get out of here. It's a need to get out of Dodge, really. Don't be like one of those storekeepers in Dodge City that's, you know, I'm staying here and protecting my store. And you're hunkered down in the store and pew, 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 bullets are flying all over the place. And I'm staying here, protect my goods, no matter what. That's stupid. The sheriff says, hey, everybody, get out of Dodge. There's a big gunfight coming up. Get out of Dodge. Forget about your store. Get out of Dodge. Get out of Dodge. There's a better store somewhere else for you. You're not gonna, you know, if you survive it, you're still gonna be traumatized like crazy. And those who stay in this world are just gonna be traumatized nonstop, on every single level, in every single way. And they're just going to be shell-shocked to an unimaginable extent. And they will actually wanna die. The terror of seeing everything happen in this world is so bad. People stay who want to die. They think, oh my gosh, that'd be much better to know the stuff take place. What's happening to our world? It's being torn to pieces. And how could this happen? Of course, it's in the Bible, the end times, the tribulation period, the angels pouring out the vials of tribulation upon the world. Of course, that's exactly what's going to happen, really. but you don't have to couch it in archaic terms at all. You can upgrade all that and get it very direct, very clear, right here, modern terminology, and right use of time. Boy, this rain is way heavier than they said. They said there'd be a few sprinkles today, and we're just getting downpour, and it's been pouring for hours. Gosh. Whew. And that's a good example, really. People may think, oh, World War III, well, okay, whatever. No, it's going to be so intense. You won't be able to function. And your whole notion of everything is going to be torn to shreds. You're just going to feel that as if death were real. You're going to feel that way. The fantasy will become so intense, you will feel like, you will feel as if you've convinced mind that death is real, even though you haven't. And in that case, you're going to end up in severe depression and chaotic mind state. Absolutely. Which I'll be able to help with that. Absolutely, I can help. Because I've been there, done that. Certainly. It's not like the people in the death-free realm are not going to help. Of course they're going to help. They will help calm down those who pass over. Maybe those who want to get out, they need to go to recovery places. Places that are probably planets that help you recover from this situation, really. Because this is it. This is the end of the world, as it were. And of course you're going to have to go somewhere else and cool out from what's happened here if you stay. So those who get to safety first, get to the death-free realm first, they of course will be viable to help out others. What happened here? Just dropped out. No available bandwidth. Okay, it just does weird stuff sometimes. So, oh yeah, of course. It's not like those who sidestep are never going to be involved. No, they're going to be probably intensely involved with rescue missions, with missions of help, and all that kind of stuff. But they're going to know very well how to get out of Dodge, too. They're going to know very well about the real world, about the death-free realm. They're going to be knowing very well that they cannot be harmed in any way. They're going to understand the nature of hypotheticals. They're going to be able to be very, very helpful. Very helpful. In the big picture, extremely helpful. But they're not going to be hanging out on the battlefield, most likely. Theoretically, that could always happen too. You know, someone could show up on a battlefield to calm everybody or something. Yeah, of course. I mean, that is possible too. I wouldn't put that off the table. Something that could happen. There could be gurus show up in the world to help calm people down. But that's not nearly as helpful or as good as getting out of Dodge before it all happens. That's way better, because then you'll be able to be part of the solution instead of the problem. And you'll set a good example for everybody, and then you'll be also clued into how to help. You'll have the longest time to figure out how to help the best. So it's a win-win-win-win-win-win-win-win-win-win situation. The sooner you get out of Dodge, the better, actually. The more helpful you will be. So it's just a very, again, practical, useful thing to do. I'm ready to go right now, actually. I don't feel any trepidation at all. Looking forward to it. And of course, most people right now will still say, can't think that's just a fantasy. Well, absolutely. All of existence is a fantasy. So it's just another fantasy, exactly. But it's a fantasy that's useful, because it will remind us of reality. And then we can set fantasies down altogether at that point. So I'm ready to go. And ready to help out. And again, World War III's already started. That is the news of the day. It's the news of tomorrow, the news of the next day. And you're probably hearing it here first, which is a great thing. The whole idea of this channel here is to, this YouTube channel is to get the information ahead of time. You hear it here first. So you're informed, you're pre-informed, which is right use of time, and it's being super smart. You're informed ahead of time. You say, okay, I already know World War III's already started. I know that. And so I'm already saying, okay, what's my right use of time given what the situation is actually is? And again, You don't see the artillery and the bullets flying out, but actually you do see them flying and all these shootings taking place. But it starts at the psychic level. Warfare always starts at the psychic level, and thought forms are used like a virus. It's like infecting a computer virus. It really is like a phishing scam, actually, the way they do it. They try to get you to click and accept this thought form as your own. It's like a phishing scam. So it's like, imagine if someone was able to send a phishing scam to everybody's computer in the world. Everybody, smartphone, computer, everybody has all these phishing scams. They click here, and the dumb people get fooled, and they click, and it puts the scam is on your computer now. You got the virus, and it's like key loggers, or, you know, it steals all your information, or crashes your computer, ruins your, all that kind of stuff. That's exactly what they're doing. Is they've sent out phishing scams to everybody in the world, psychic phishing scams, where you're supposed to accept the way you accept this phishing scam, and you think it's your own. Now your own volition that you're acting on, that's coming from your own highest wisdom or something, where it's not. And so then you start becoming impulsive and confrontational and violent. And you become impulsive, and all this stuff snowballs. And before you know it, you're one of the brown shirts knocking on doors. And for those of you who are too young to know what that is, that's the Waffen from the SS, from the Nazis, who would go into the towns and the villages and the cities, etc., of all the places they had annexed, and they would simply round up all the people that they had intelligence on. They'd gather intelligence very quickly, and they didn't care about being too precise, and they'd knock on the doors, and does such and such live here? Oh, okay. And the stormtroopers would go into the house and pull the people out of the house and throw them in a van. Off they'd go, never to be seen again. Just like that. No trial. And people are going to become just like that in this world, and worse. There is actually a preparation for all this kind of stuff going on, and you may even notice it and not quite put two and two together. But I have been very interestingly interrupted several times when I'm taping here by solicitors for causes, so-called causes. You know those causes. We're going to shut down those bad guys that are doing this bad stuff, the people who's doing stuff we don't like, who are saying stuff we don't like, we're going to shut them down. We want your signature, we want your money, all this kind of stuff. So what they have is they have smartphones. They all have smartphones. Actually, what happens is a whole group of them descend on a neighborhood. They all have smartphones, and they're all in contact. They have a network, and they share information, and they go around, and they canvass the whole neighborhood, and what they do is they log each address that they go, they click on this, they add to log it, and was anyone home, and did they agree to support it or disagree? Okay, that's all that information is data, and then all that data then is downloaded or uploaded to a central database. And so what's happening right now is the central database, what's been going on for a long time, but it's intense now. They're putting together a central database of everybody in the country, as many people as they can get, of who sides with what. Who sides with what. Now let's say someone comes to your door and says, we want to shut down this right-wing organization, and we want your signature to do that. And you say, well, you know, this is just not my thing, you know, good luck, but I'm not really into trying to shut down freedom of speech or whatever, and it's just not my thing, so no. Or maybe I don't have the money, whatever. So they'll log you as refuse to do this. Refusal. You are now labeled with a mark meaning refusal. You refuse to support. In other words, you're not for them. You refused. Doesn't matter what your excuse is. They don't say, what's your excuse? They said, you refused. And the ones who went along with them, they say, agreed. So in the central database, and they have algorithms going through all this information, is they will. Algorithms will go through and put all the people who have agreed with all these key kind of causes that they're using as an excuse, and then you will then be on the list of those who are good guys, that you're meant to be put in positions of authority over others. The ones who refused the most stuff, maybe refused a lot of stuff, you're now on the bottom of the list, and you're a very dangerous person. You're a person that is an obstructionist, and you're put on the list to be eliminated. Okay, So we think, oh, no, this could never happen. It's happening this very instant in your neighborhood, actually, right this minute. These people who are canvassing, asking for all these causes, are sending all this information to central databases, our very satellite databases, which then get also put into centralized databases, and where algorithms will chew through everything and sort everything out. And if you refuse these people, you will be on the list saying you're an obstructionist. And then when the brown shirts get all organized, which they will, the head knockers, if you're on that bad list of refusers, you're going to be the ones dragged out of your home. So all of this is taking place right now with all the technology that we have. That's what's being utilized for, which I knew ahead of time that's exactly what it's going to be utilized for. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about, all the software and mobile phones, etc. Ultimately, its purpose is to... Now, there will be all sorts of committees that decide who lives and who dies. All of that sort of stuff's going to take place. And a lot of those... There's a lot of coffee clutches going on right now. Oh, they have been going on for quite some time, of setting up the book clubs. Those are all covers, actually, for forming committees. Just like the Nazis did ahead of time. They had all sorts of stuff that were actually preparatory for what took place later, and it all seemed kind of pretty innocent. Not, we're just having book clubs. We get together every week and we discuss blah blah this book. What you're doing is you're getting used to communicating with one another. Ultimately, that gets used to decide who lives and who dies, and you get this group of people together. They meet, and then they're given a list, and they're shown all the marks against them and all the data, and then they're going to decide, what is the priority? Who in this group we want to eliminate first, and who we're going to send to re-education, who we want to eliminate, who we're going to send to labor camps, who we're going to, all this sort of, who we're going to give, injections, and all these things. They're actually going to be the ones deciding these things. And the funny thing is, which I've known, of course, all along, that feminism was just a cover for setting up these groups, because most of the decisions would be done by women. Females will be doing, most of the ones doing the deciding who lives and dies will be done by women. They're the ones in charge of that. And the men will carry out the dirty work. Just like in the Nazi death camps, who were most of the guards who carried out? Men, of course. Of course they were. Okay, the men do the dirty work. Ultimately, the way it's set up, the way that's most smoothly, efficiently, is the women do the deciding who lives and who dies, because they're very, very adept at that sort of thing. I mean, they've been trained. Of course, another reason for feminism is that there was a knowledge that was sent forth in this world. We knew that most of the men are going to die in these wars. And this war is coming up. And so the women said, we have to survive on our own. There may not be very many men around at all. So we have to be a very cohesive feminine unit to continue on with civilization. That's another very strong reason that feminism arose. But all out of that also came another purpose for it. First it was a practical purpose, because there was a knowing ahead of time that there's going to be this huge culling of population, huge war. And of course in the war most of the dying will be done by men. So women will have to help each other and get along and do all that kind of stuff. So that's why most feminists don't pay any attention to men. They got no use for them, because they say, well, a couple years from now you'll all be dead anyway, so why should I spend any time even talking with you? Which is practical, right? See, I'm not against the practicality of that. I understand it entirely. It's practical, sure. But there's another side to it all. And those are the committees that will be set up, who lives and who dies. So, again, all the situation is actually taking place super fast right now. Proposition 8 in California, it was a red flag of all red flags, wasn't it? Because in that situation, what happened was there was an intense effort to find out everybody that was pro 8 and log their names and get a database on all those people, especially everyone that contributed to it. Everyone that contributed was made a target, and their names were recorded, and they got a hold of all that data. I think there's some court decision says that data cannot be secret, hidden. And then reprisals were carried out against those who supported Prop 8 in California. And some of them were severe harassment took place on some against some of the major donors. They became viciously targeted just because they supported a political initiative, a social initiative. But technology was heavily used for that. They went around and said, you know, we signed this petition to you know, invalidate Prop 8, and basically they go door to door and try to find out what your position is on Prop 8. And then they record whether you're for or against it. And if you're, you know, if you were for Prop 8, then you are the enemy. You are the enemy, you see. That's exactly what happened in California. And now this is going to be done on a global scale right now. Is they're going about trying to find out who the enemy is among us. The enemy among us. Who are they? You know, who are they want to find out? Are you a right-winger? Do you support traditional marriage? Do you support Christianity? Do you support... all these people are enemies now. Enemies of the state. And they're trying to find out exactly who all these people are. And they have a pretty good idea already. The screws, they'll start tightening the screws very soon. And here's the thing. Let's say you're just neutral, which is what I am. They're still an enemy. Still an enemy. Because I see the folly of it all. When you see the folly of it all, you just say, this is just a waste of time. Why even look at any of this stuff at all? Let's just go to the death-free realm. Today, right now. What are we wasting our time talking about issues? That's totally stupid. We can be free right now. There are no issues in the death-free realm. There's only exquisite beauty. What are we wasting our time arguing about marriage or arguing about this or arguing about that? Is crazy. Total knuckleheadness, really. But see, from their standpoint, they see you as an enemy because you're not for them. You're not trying to make death real, so you're an enemy. If you're not trying to make death real, they see you as an extreme enemy to be eliminated, actually. Absolutely eliminated. And they've run test runs like in China, Communist China, Soviet Union, Nazi Germany, various places, Cambodia, central, various places in Africa, Romania, the Eastern Bloc countries. Absolutely. All that stuff was trial runs. The Iron Curtain, you know, descended on Eastern Europe. Lots of places around the world. There's all these test runs to try to figure out how to do it better and better and better here. And so now they've got the technology to find out who the enemy within is. Who to round up. They're more sophisticated now. And they could communicate boom, 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 boom. They don't have to have a central commander. You see, it's now diffuse because everyone has these smartphones. All the young people who are the fascists. Let's face it, they're the brown shirts. You don't see many older people doing this. You don't. They say, no. This is not kosher. Forget it. No way. Some of them, a few real knuckleheads are trying to stay with that. But most of this is getting carried out by the young people, younger generations, the generation of the brown shirts, Nazi youth. You know, the people who carried out World War II and not for the Nazis were Nazi youth who were raised in all these preparatory ways, and they were totally into it. The youth. There's a whole generation that was really into it. That's what they wanted to do. That's what they came here to do. Let's make death real. So they, you know, they were happy to have that skull on their caps, you know, shock stormtroopers, SS. And there was like a total honor for them. That's what they trained for their whole lives for. So we have a generation right now of people who have trained to find out, to mark who all the enemies are. That's what they want to do. They want to find out who are the enemies of the great plan to make death real. Wow, that's a real enemy, huh? It's just, so whoever's smart here is really in harm's way, right? Because the smarter you are, you more realize what absolute folly this world is, isn't, don't you? It's ridiculous. Total waste of time. So you then are the great enemy. You have to laugh. It's so stupid, isn't it? It's so funny. So don't forget to laugh. Keep a sense of humor. And I don't have my face like all like that. You know, it's like I've got a sense of lightness about it and humor. Because you got to. It's all silly. It's all totally silly. Yet also, you don't want to be traumatized to the with the carnage where you start thinking death is real, because then you'll be afraid of the real of the death-free realm. You'll be afraid of reality. You don't want to return to reality. You're too afraid to. Because then you think, well, I got to survive it. All this, we got to figure out a way to dwell then in this death-based realm, and you'll get hooked into that, and it'll delay you, intensely delay you. You don't want that. It's possible to get delayed severely. Even though this is all just a hypothetical scenario, you can keep thinking it's totally, not only is it totally necessary, you think that you really found the way to do it, and then you got to finish it up, and that delays you just interminably. And you don't want that. So you want to sidestep it. The smarter you are, you say, hey, really got to sidestep this situation. See, I knew ahead of time I'm gonna be on top on the list, one of the top on the list of, hey, this guy he's not into trying to make death real. So I said, I better find a way to get out of here. That's definitely. And we see, it's a different ballgame now. In the past, like the Jews could go in World War II, the Jews and the gays and the gypsies and all those people that were targeted for elimination, when there are many more, they could go somewhere, like France, Great Britain, America, other countries. They could flee Germany, right? But in the situation right now, where can you go to flee this global technology? With all the satellites and technology they have, they can take images of like a dime on the ground from satellites. They know where you are. They can track you. They can find out where you are. They can do all their culling. I mean, they have armies of young people who feel that this is like their salvation to do this, is track down the bad guys, track down the enemies. They'll track you down anywhere here. What do you think you're going to do? You're going to go hide in some jungle somewhere? Go down to somewhere down in Eastern... you know, some boondocks, some jungle way, 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 way back where nobody is, and hide in a cave or something. They'll track you down. They will track you down. Be extremely difficult to not get tracked down now. And I don't think you can hide underground either, because I think that probably those who are underground are in cahoots with this whole thing too. So it's not necessarily you're going to be protected underground. I don't know exactly. I haven't really looked at that. But you'll be tracked down. Of course, they want to put every purchase electronically marked, and who's doing the purchasing, so they can track you that way too. They'll institute that. There'll be a long process of tracking everybody down, of eliminating all the enemies. Long process. It'll go on and on and on and on and on. They'll get more and more sophisticated, more and more terrible. You know, just like the Nazis, they got more and more sophisticated at it. They got more intelligence added, so they go into a city, and they know exactly who they wanted to get and where their address was, where they were staying, and they'd come in and smooth through a suite and get them all. They became very sophisticated. That's the Diary of Anne Frank, was an example of someone that was like hiding out somewhere so they wouldn't get taken by the Nazis, you see. People realized that they were coming, and they tried to hide out, but you won't be able to hide out like that anymore. It'll be very difficult and a stupid thing to do. I mean, it's stupid to try think you're going to be able to do that. I know that a lot of people are trying to be survivalists. They're, well, we're going to go up to Canada, and we're going to hang out in Canada, up there in the north, the great north, and we'll be fishing and hunting, and growing our own food. We've got some organic chickens, some organic farm up there. We'll be fine. Well, not true. Not true at all. Because through satellites, I mean, the data's like that. It's instantaneous. They'll know there's somebody driving a car there. They know there's a camp there. They'll know that there's people there. Who are these people? Why are they camping? How come they haven't checked in? Let's do a check on them. Pew! Helicopter comes in, lands. Bunch of people get out. Bunch of brown shirts get out. They come in and say, hey, folks, we're just doing a check on you. You got your ID? Check your ID. Run your ID through a central database, find out you got all these strikes against you, say, and then call in a transport plane or whatever, truck or whatever, it's an operation, come in, throw you in the truck, throw you in the train, and then you take you to the train, take you to some re-education camp or somewhere else where you don't want to go. Just like that. You can't be hiding out somewhere. They'll know if you're canoeing on a river. They got satellites, hundreds of satellites, spy satellites, capable of tracking whatever they want to track. They can track it. Infrared stuff, all sorts of different subtle energy wavelengths can pick up stuff at night, can pick up stuff you wouldn't believe. So the idea that somehow you're going to skate scot-free is ludicrous. You're going to be checked on. They're going to go sweep through the whole planet, everyone on the whole planet. Like, why do you think all this technology came into the world in the first place? That's exactly why. They are hell-bent on identifying everyone on this planet, without exception. Not even one person will not be identified and knowing where they stand. And making sure that they go along with the program. And of course, this will be all somewhat chaotic too. There'll be wars and terrible stuff taking place. But there also will be all these internal sweeps of who's for us and who's against us type of stuff. So I never planned to be a survivalist. I did not. For a brief time, I got into it and I said, well, this isn't going to work. This is stupid. It's a waste of time. It's a waste of time. What am I going to do? Throw up some teepee up in Alaska? They'll zoom in on you eating your breakfast in Alaska. Say, who's that? We don't have that. And facial recognition. Why do you think facial recognition is being used? All the software. Why do you think Facebook's being used? All this stuff is to get faces of everybody in the world. And so you can zoom in on a spy satellite, grab someone's face who's eating breakfast outside a teepee in Alaska, and run that facial recognition stuff to know who it is. Or say, we don't know who that is, which means we need to send somebody there to find out who it is. You see how that works? And if they don't know who you are, then they'll pull you into identification camps where they run all these series of psychological tests where your brain is all hooked up to stuff. And they'll run these tests to see where you stand on stuff, what your reactions are, like some super sophisticated lie detector sort of test on you. And they'll find out where you stand on stuff, like, how do you feel about gay marriage? You know, something like that. They'll approach it, and then they say, oh, you don't really like it, huh? Okay, there's a strike, you know, whatever, at least the tests are done. Where do you stand about women serving in the military and armed forces or something? Where do you stand about, you know, all these issues, these hot button issues? What about abortion? How do you think about abortion? What do you think about Jesus Christ? So many hot button issues. What do you think about the president? They'll find out what your reactions are, and then mark those will all be turned into data. It'll be data, and you will be then categorized. So don't think just because you don't have identification that you're scot-free. You say, oh, nobody knows who I am. I don't have any ID. They can't track me. They don't. No. They'll say, we don't know who this is, round you up, and run a series of tests on you. And then they say, well, this one's okay. He's with us. Or this one needs to be sent to one of these camps because they're potentially threatening to our program, our agenda. So, again, that's why I did not promote survivalism. Waste of time. These young folks are very, very serious, very thorough. They have no hesitation about intruding upon your privacy. None. They come up to the door. I say, hey, I'm busy. And they say, well, it won't take long. They say, it won't take long. All right? So let's say you're hiding out somewhere and someone comes up and says, hey, I don't want to be found. I'm cool. I'm just hiding. They say, well, it won't take long. There won't be a problem for you. We're just gonna run a few scans on you. Here's your facial scan, fingerprint scan, all this stuff. We're just collecting some data. We're just cultural anthropologists collecting data on human population on the planet or something. You can just read the attitudes of people here. If you're very smart, you can read attitudes of people easily. So you know that there's a vast armada of young people on this planet, that their whole purpose, this is their purpose, is to identify everyone, to classify everybody, to put everybody into groups and categories. Now, just recently, well, this has been going on for a long time, but there's some people that have been speaking out recently who said very innocuous things, like Phil Mickelson, the golfer, who's a very beloved person, actually. He's a very, very nice person. I met his dad. His dad was a super, super guy, just super. He was also an ace pilot, his dad, I think in the Korean War. Comes from a great family, and he's a super charitable, helpful individual. Yeah, and so he's one of the good guys, and he just mentioned that, hey, this with the new taxes and everything, he just says in California, he just says, wow, this isn't working well for me. It's really, because I'm sure he has a lot of foundations. He does a lot of stuff. He actually does so many good works. He doesn't even advertise them to anybody. If someone needs help, he'll help them. Really, he's known for that. And doesn't even, you know, sometimes someone say, hey, this word leaks out. Someone will tell him that he did this for me. But he doesn't even want people to know about it. So he said he feels he has a right to use his money charitably how he wants to. He doesn't want to have all his so much of his money taken in taxes. So that the government decides how to use those taxes. How is the government going to use those taxes? To fund all these identification programs. Of course. His money is going to be used to help fund this, what's global fascism is really what it is. He doesn't want that. He didn't say it that way, but he said, hey, I don't want to be taxed so heavily. I may have to move out of California like Tiger Woods did back in 1990, was it 96 or 8 or whatever, because he was getting taxed too heavily, and now it's going to be really heavy. And my gosh, he just, the firestorm went, you know, came down on him. And he had to backtrack. So I'm so sorry to say this. He had to apologize and apologize. For what? For what? For simply being honest? Speaking his mind? This is how I feel? I mean, my gosh. So this is happening all over the place. That people who stand up and just express common sense, their individual rights and liberties, etc., are being viciously attacked. The owner of Whole Foods recently expressed how he doesn't like the healthcare program and some other things, and he came to the Bay Area, and he says he's being so viciously attacked. He said, my God, this is horrible. And he's like, you know, one of the icons of whatever Whole Foods stands for, and he's getting absolutely ripped. Intolerant. He talks something about fascism. I use that word, and oh my gosh, people go absolutely crazy. Who goes crazy? The fascists go crazy. They don't like to have a mirror held up to them. And these people, I meet these young people, oh my God. Of course, not all, but those who are these fascists, just like not everyone in Germany was a Hitler Youth, not everyone, young people, are these global fascists at all. But the ones that are, holy cow, holy cow. They look at you. The way they view you is really something. Red flags are like flying up all over the place. They might as well be wearing swastikas, really. And maybe we should say, where's your swastika? I don't know. You put it, you misplace it? Because it's exactly the attitude they have. They feel that you have to obey them. So I said, not now. It's like, hey, you can't say that to me. You can't say no to me. You can't say no to our agenda. You can't say no to our effort to make death real. Who are you to say no to that? And you get too much of that, it wears on you, and you start feeling intimidated, and you want to shut up. It's a problem. So that's why I say get out of Dodge. Don't be stupid. Don't be stupid. If the Holy Spirit says get out of Dodge, get out of Dodge. I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, I can stand up to them, because I probably cannot. Probably cannot, because I'm too kind-hearted to that. Too kind-hearted and compassionate, and I'm not confrontational, so... Why would I want a confrontation? I don't feel any need for any confrontation. And they're like a super confrontational. And they've got you classified. They're just there to classify you. Really? Are they there to communicate? No, they're there to classify. They're there to classify you. That's the purpose. That's the feeling I get from these people. Is they simply are classifying you. Whereas when I meet somebody, I'm just... saying, what's the right use of time here? What is the right use of time? How can we use this time the right way? How can we look at truth together? How can we share the right use of time together? Let us. Is that? What about salvation? Where are we in terms of salvation? How's this situation? How can it be used to tune into salvation, the God's plan of salvation? That's how I look at situations. So I'm not looking to classify people, but when I'm getting all these, when someone's trying to classify me, then I'm aware of it. So they're classifying themselves when they do that. And they're putting themselves in the classification of those who are only here to classify others. So I'm not going to be stupid and not be unaware of that, of course. But that's not my motive. I'm still willing to say, let's talk about salvation. No, they're not interested in that. Not interested in that. They say, we already know what our roles are. They already know what their roles are. They've trained for them. They've came in here. They pre-prepared before they even came to this planet. And they pre-prepared, and they're all ready to carry out their roles now. So they don't need to listen to us. Their only purpose is to carry out their roles. Okay. Well, we'll carry out our roles, which is a sidestep it. And they say, that's not on my sheet. I didn't prepare for that. Well, that's okay. I'm not holding that against you. Yeah, I say, no, I'm not holding that against you. That's all right. They say, yeah, but I'm going to fail. That's okay. How can you fail at the accomplish the impossible? That's just ludicrous. There's still a place for you in the death-free realms? Absolutely. I'll keep a seat warm for you. No problem. I say, well, we can't fail, because if we fail, well, what are you trying to do? You're trying to make death real. Well, that's a non-starter from the very, very beginning. Since it's a completely impossible from the very beginning, how could there be any failure? The term failure is meaningless. So you're not failing. You're just follying or whimsy. You're whimsic. And I don't know if I can make a word out of that. Whimsicaling. You're whimsicaling. And you're being very totally eccentrically extravagant. That's all. You're just being very, very eccentric and extravagant and whimsical. Which is okay. It's not a failure. No failure. It's not failure. The term failure is not even involved in this equation. So temporarily, they're so eccentric. They're playing this imaginary game of being a failure. So you just have to let them play that game. That's okay. They'll wise up at some point. The mind is still untouched by its dreams of its destruction and fragmentation and hypotheticals. The mind is just untouched by it. So of course that they will realize. The nature of the mind is untouched at some point, and then they'll start becoming really, really smart. It's just that we don't have to wait for that point. I mean, we will wait for it, but we'll wait for it in the real world, and we know it's going to happen for them for sure. And we'll wait for them in reality, which no one's ever left. But we won't wait here, because we don't need to. Because they say, I will fail if you leave. There's no failure. What you'll do is you'll just continue to be very eccentric for a while, which is okay. You see, you have to be very smart about this. Otherwise, you're going to get caught up in their insanity, as if failure is some option. It's not failure. It's just this attempt to make death real is this complete eccentricity, an extravagant whimsicality. That's all it is, and that's okay. Doesn't hurt anything, doesn't threaten anything. It's just a completely silly game is all. Fine, there's no problem. They want to claim that they failed, that's okay. That's again an eccentricity, that's all. It's not failure. If they want to call eccentricity failure, that's just a definitional game they're playing. Let them play it. Let them play the game. Just mind games they're playing. Let them play. That's okay. You have to stop them. They're not harming the mind. They're not harming anything. They're just delaying. They're wasting their time. They're being eccentric, which is fine. God didn't say that the sun cannot be eccentric. That option is also available, and we use that option. But God is not saying that's what you should be doing. He said, you're free, you do whatever you want to do. If you want to be eccentric, you can. But you're not going to be happy. You're not going to be happy that way. You're going to be fearful. So it's not a good choice. It's not a choice you're going to like. And if you get perfect freedom, there's going to be one choice you don't like. I mean, the choice to try to become prime creator, you're not going to like that choice. It's going to be fearful. All the rest of the stuff is great. But that particular idea is going to, you're not going to like it. God just said, hey, I'm created you perfectly free, but keep in mind that if you try to become prime creator, you won't enjoy that experience at all. You won't really enjoy it. It's a waste of your time. But you're free to choose that idea if you want to, of course. And so what do? We said, okay, let's choose that idea. I wonder what that's like. And here we are. Here we are now. It's fun to talk about this stuff. It's really quite a bit of humor, quite a bit of lightness. Everything lightens up. As you see it, you start lightening up. And you say, hey, it's not as bad as I thought. It really isn't. I really can sidestep it. It's really okay. I'm not causing anyone to fail. That's great. So you lighten up more and more and more and more and more. Whereas you talk about the other stuff in the world, it's like you feel you going, get heavier and heavier and heavier. And yeah, who's going to win the Super Bowl? You know, ah, boy, you start talking about that before you know it, you feel like lead. You know, oh, God. If you talk about this, it's more and more humorous, more and more wonderful, more and more great. You say, oh, my gosh, I'm not really causing my brother to fail. Not at all. I'm perfectly free to leave. I'm not causing any failures. Where's the guilt? There's no guilt. Not causing anyone to suffer. That's all their own fantasy. They want to suffer. That's another. Suffering is also an eccentricity. Not causing anyone to die. That's an eccentricity too. All that stuff is just total eccentricity. Incredible eccentricity. When we see what's really true here, we will see all our brothers in spirit just like they're like skunk drunk, you know, just like super, super eccentric. Just engaging in the most incredible eccentricity of getting sick and dying and thinking that their body and thinking this is their home and all this stuff is hilarious. I just have to laugh at that. It's like playing this cuckoo game, absolutely cuckoo. But they're all, you know, having fun, pretending to have fun too, acting all this out, imagining all this stuff out. But they don't have to do it. They're just really into it. They're role-playing, really into it. And that's okay. No problem. Not all aspects of spirit have to be into that. There's nothing that says everyone has to be into that. Nothing that says we even have to watch them be eccentric. No. It's not necessary. We don't have to role-play along with them. They're free. They're free, we're free. Everyone's free to choose whatever experience they want. Everyone's free. So you're not hurting their freedom by choosing another idea? Not at all. If they say you are, that's just part of their eccentricity. They're acting out the role of being insane. It's very eccentric being insane, acting insanity, isn't it? Very eccentric. And very whimsical and extravagant. Those three terms. Whimsical, eccentric, and extravagant. That applies. That describes the world. It describes what's going on very well. So, we're getting close. That's great. All this stuff is like just sorting out. Just sort it out and say, oh, okay. No big deal. Easy. Easy come, easy go. And of course, the people that stay, they think they're going to have a great old, good old time. It's like George Jones having a good old time, and then he ended up in a mental hospital, weighed like about 100 pounds or 90-something or whatever, and he was like a couple days away from death, and then he, you know, was hell. Later on, he said, well, we were just a bunch of good old boys trying to have fun, that's all, and didn't turn out to be too fun. So that's what it's like. You know, I made choices from the day that I was born. I heard voices that told me right from wrong. If I had listened, I wouldn't be where I am today, living and dying with the choices that I've made. That's a song by George Jones, Choices. And that's very true. So everybody here in this world, you know, they're just trying to have fun. And those who are going to stay on the battleground, they think that this is going to be really fun. They're really going to try to make death real, and they think, this should be really fun, this should be great. I just can't wait to get on with it. And later on, they won't think it's so fun. But in retrospect, they'll say, well, yeah, just a bunch of good old boys trying to have fun, you know. Yeah, that's what we did, and didn't have a whole lot of fun, I tell you that. But glad to get out of it, glad to get out of it. And they will be glad to get out of it. They'll be very happy to go to the death-free realm at some point. Very happy indeed, actually. They'll say, wow, I'm really happy to be here. That what I did before, that wasn't so much fun. We just tried to have a good old time, but turned out to be kind of a really terrible, nasty time. So, that's something to look forward to. You know, you can look forward to all aspects of spirit coming to the death-free realms and abiding there for a while. And so they remember reality. Everyone will eventually show up there, so that's a great thing to look forward to. Great thing to look forward to. Temporarily, they're going to be very eccentric for a while. That's okay. I had experience that showed me what to prepare for one day. And I was in a beautiful, one of the most beautiful places on the planet, actually. And hardly anybody knows about it. And it was so beautiful that I wonder if I have video of that. I probably do somewhere, actually. It's on tape, though. It was before a memory cards. And it was amazing. It was exquisite. We just sat there quietly. Everyone just sat there quietly. Didn't need to say hardly anything. And some we'd smile and joke and laugh and just sit there. It's like, wow, perfect day, so beautiful, good grief. And so we left there in this super high condition, just of joy, driving down the road, canyon road, and suddenly the traffic, I saw cars stopped ahead of me, and then I saw a whole group of people in the middle of the road, and I said, uh-oh, this doesn't look good. And my heart started dropping. I told my friends, stay here, and I'm going to go see what's going on, because I had a sense that something's really bad happened. I didn't want him to deal with it. He was an older person. And I went up there, and sure enough, a car had turned over. Volkswagen Bug, Red Beetle, made in Germany, of course, and it had flipped and turned over quite a few times, going around a turn too fast, and in doing so, it had expelled the occupants. Apparently, they weren't wearing seat belts. I don't know how they were thrown out of the vehicle, but anyway, they were. And there was one guy unconscious on the road who was bleeding from their ears and nose, and he looked like he was in very, very, very bad condition. There was another who was on the side of the road jumping around, who was in absolute trauma and shock, and was like incoherent, and was just freaking out, completely freaking out. And then there were two others who were scraped and scuffed up, but who had survived it. Maybe they were wearing seatbelts, probably. I think the ones in the front wearing seatbelts, a couple, two in the back were not, I think. So the ones wearing seatbelts were okay, but they were in shock, of course. And so I basically took over at the scene and called 911. No one had called 911. I called 911. I was able to get through and get things going. And then I started trying to calm everybody down. And I had to sit there and with the guy that was on the ground, you know, praying for him. And it was terrible, really terrible. And eventually the paramedics arrived. And so what happened was, once they arrived, then they said, okay, we got it covered, thank you very much. And then I said, wow, we couldn't get through, we still couldn't get through. So I said, I don't wanna stay here on the battleground, the scene of this accident. This is a terrible downer. And we couldn't go anywhere. So I said, let's just go back up the road to the place we left, which was super, super beautiful place, and let's just hang out there. And so we went up there and ordered some food, and we just hung around this little lake and just calmed down and took the beauty in and just stayed there until finally we gave it, I don't know, a couple hours or whatever it took. And we just stayed there for a long time. And then we got in our car and we drove back down and the road was clear and we were able to go back home. But I was acutely aware at that time that I was shown this whole thing was part of being tuned into what's going to happen in the world. It's called the turnover times, which great tribulation. And that's going to happen. And it's probable, like there's probably a quarter of the world is going to be killed, most likely, maybe half. And then the ones that don't die are going to be in terrible shock and trauma of seeing all this carnage and stuff also. And I was aware that, yeah, these times are going to happen, and the way to deal with it is just to get out of Dodge, go to the death-free realms and just stay there. Let the dead bury the dead, as it were. So that's exactly what I realized at that point. There's some necessity here. I see that there's some things you need to just sidestep. There's nothing I could do. I couldn't, you know, at that point, I'd done everything I could do. And it was time for me to be refreshed and calm down and not have to be traumatized by the situation. So, and that's always stuck with me, entirely stuck with me, saying, wow, I know there's a turnover time coming. There's no question it's going to come. We're at that time now. And at some point, you just say, hey, it doesn't do any point to stay here and see all the carnage. It doesn't do any good at all. Because it's not going to make it real. And that's the whole purpose of it. So you're wasting your time. And there is a place to go. There is a place to go. That's the whole point of the situation. It was showing me, hey, there is a place to go. You can hang out in these beautiful realms. They're extremely beautiful places to hang out. Extremely beautiful. More beautiful than this world by far. Take everything that's best about this world and multiply it by many factors and you'll have places to hang out. And there ultimately a death-free realm is available, and that's indescribably wonderful. So you don't have to stay here. You don't have to stay here during these troubles. There's a lot of people not wearing their seatbelts. I mean, there's a lot of impulsive people in the world now. A lot. Not like 10 or 20. We're not talking about that. We're not talking about 100 million. We're talking about, I don't know, billion, 2 billion. Could be billions of very impulsive people, or at least, you know, vast quantities of people who have been trained and ready to be impulsed. Impulse ninjas, as they are. Impulse ninjas. Be activated by thought forms, psychic thought forms. So they're going to go about their thing here. And there are some who don't want to do that, but they feel they need to stay here. The kind of nice, good people. And it's interesting, at the site, the guy that was, I hope he survived, I kind of doubt that he did, really. I fear that he may not have, I don't know. But anyway, he was like covered in tattoos, this guy. And he had been using drugs, his friend said, and I think they had all been using some, but this guy was really... He was, you know, his vibe was like a death vibe. He really had a death vibe about him. The other one that got really badly traumatized also was like a skinhead type. These guys are like skinhead types of folks, but really heavy death vibe about him. The other two were like very preppy guys. I was wondering, what the hell are you got preppy guys doing hanging out with these death vibe guys? It didn't make sense. They look like they're from very good preppy family. They look very decent, kindly sort of kids. They're like getting messed up with drugs or something, and they didn't get hurt. They're wearing seatbelts, but they got badly traumatized by what happened. I could tell in their faces and their eyes. It was a deep shock to them. Deep shock. They're badly shocked by it. So what I'm saying is, those in the world who may not be killed, may not die, may have connections, whatever, somehow they're not engaged in the carnage so much on the battlefield, they will still be deeply, deeply traumatized by this. They'll have fantasies of deep trauma. So the survivors will be deeply, have fantasies of deep trauma. Very, very bad. So it's stupid to stay in this situation on the battleground. You're either going to die or be severely traumatized. What good is that? How useful is that? It's not useful at all. So nobody in that group was in good shape. They all paid a severe price. So it's better to not to go around a turn too fast, and yet in this world they're doing that. So for me, better to go back up to that beautiful place where I was at and just hang out. Just enjoy the ambience for a little, you know, for a while. Yeah. Absolutely. But that shock stayed with me and to this day and provided tremendous motivation for me and has been helped driving me forward, saying, wow, you know what's coming. There's a saying, the turnover times is when the times suddenly turn, okay? And we're in that, it's begun in earnest now. On the January 20th inauguration day, it began in earnest. The turnover times began in earnest. And we're going to flip over very soon. We're going to turn over very, very soon. The times are going to turn over into something that is just like flipping over, like a car flipping over. Like that. You're like, if you're in a car, you're going to feel like your vehicle just flipping over and flipping over. And you're just out of control. It's going to feel out of control. Out of control. Very soon. And you don't want to be around for that. Who wants to feel that out of control? It's crazy. So, I'm working like great. I'm working nonstop, night and day, to give people the feeling there is hope. There is hope, and I'm not all freaked out or traumatized or thinking this is too big. Like it's not the situation is not too big for me. No way, it's not. You can wrap your mind around it, the whole situation, easily. You really can. And I'm able to do that. I'm able to wrap my mind around this world, other worlds, the death-free realm, other dimensions. What's going to happen in this world, transport, ability to sidestep, this whole thing, I'm able to wrap my mind around it without any problem. So, it shouldn't be any problem. There should be help. Help should arrive on time because you want it to. How do you be timely? Make the timely request. That's how to be timely. And it's time to get going. It's time to get going on this. And all, you know, what you can do is just kind of get used to this and start wrapping your mind around a little bit. Your mind is able to encompass the totality of the situation and existence, able to recognize it. It's trying to dumb itself down, thinking that by doing that it can make fantasies real. Because when it doesn't do that, it'll see, oh, I can't make fantasies real. That's crazy. And then it'll make right use of fantasies. But the mind can be used to see the big picture. And the more you practice it, the better you get. And the better you get, the safer it becomes for you. And the more helpful you become, actually. Because there'll be plenty of people on the battlefield that need help. There'll be plenty of people in this world who say, hey, help. We want out of this place. You know, can you help us? Help, 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 help. That's coming. So be ready to help. Be ready to help in a truly useful way. All right? Now, don't just like give them a shot of morphine or some antidepressants or, you know, that. Be ready to help in a truly useful way. Help them see that to choose a beautiful fantasy, a useful fantasy, instead of this very dark fantasy that's at play in this world. Very dark. Don't underestimate it. You should have seen the red flags coming of all this stuff that poured into the world, all this focus on the types of music and video games, but the young people were very into so many. They're preparing for their purpose here. Very dark fantasies. You see them, and you see it in commercials now, you know, like on football games. Gigantic, voracious dinosaurs coming at you on the screen with their jaws, fangs open, ready to just crunch you to pieces and all this. Very dark fantasies, and then these dark warlords and goddesses and all these things are just, you know, the whole thing is so eerily, horrifyingly, spookily dark and vicious and death-based, isn't it? And they're just eating that up for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Their whole psyche is lives on that, as it were. So what do you think they're here for? It's not light, is it? Not lightness. It's not the death-free realm, is it? If it's not, if your purpose is either, in hypotheticals, your purpose is either to try and make death real, or to accept that death cannot be made real, and to choose the non-necessity of making death real. It's either that one of the other purposes. Either to try and make death real, or not try and make death real. It's one or the other, period. So when you look at people, which is it? And of course you're looking with love and compassion. You're not trying to categorize them for the sake of punishing them. You're trying to be aware of where they're at so you can help them. It's a difference. And in fact, everybody ultimately has to, where I look at everyone is everyone can be potentially helped. So they're all in the category of being helped. You can help them eventually, but not all right now. So some are super intent on a super, super dark fantasy. Super dark. You know, they'd love to have a herd of velociraptors with them and saying, get them, and you're running away and they're coming after you and sending the velociraptors and chomping and chewing you up and consuming you like that. And like, ha ha, and they say, yeah, that made death real right there. That's another victory for death. Yeah, they'd love that. And you see, so that's very dark fantasies. Very dark fantasies here. Very, 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 very dark. And I mean, for my generation, not interested in that stuff. Are you kidding? No way. We actually like beautiful. I mean, I grew up in the flower children generation. The beautiful fantasies. We love beautiful fantasies. The more beautiful, the better. Let's have a very beautiful fantasy. This other stuff we look at and say, that's not beautiful. That's not a beautiful fantasy. That's a dark. Not interested in that. Are you kidding? And that yet there are many in this world who are intensely interested in that. And the beautiful fantasies, they spit on it. They absolutely spit on it. They say, that's the most ugly, horrible thing I've ever seen in my life. Terrible stuff. Doesn't serve their purpose, you see. Doesn't serve. Fantasies just serve your purpose. And you're either trying to make death real or you're not trying to make death real. You're either trying to develop a contingency plan in case reality is annihilated, or you're realizing there's no necessity for any contingency plan because reality could never be annihilated. It's one or the other. One or the other you're engaged in. So if you do make one classification, you do need to be aware of that. Which are you engaged in, truth or lies? Try to remember reality or try to forget reality. Try to make death real or try not to make death real. Which are you? Where are you at? Where are you at? Evaluation. That's intelligent evaluation. Intelligent evaluation. And it's only for the purpose of knowing, you know, how to help, who to help and who doesn't want help at this time, et cetera, like that. And of course, giving everyone freedom. So there you go. Again, another 2-hour talk, but it's go time. Full blast time. Full blast time right now. And so your life, don't be surprised if it feels full blast right now. Don't be surprised. But again, don't panic, okay? Because I'm telling you for sure, I have my mind wrapped around the whole thing already. And the wrapping is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So it can be done. So don't worry. Don't worry. There are those, I guarantee you, who already have their mind completely wrapped around it. Someone like Jesus Christ has his mind wrapped around it entirely, perfectly. Though there are those who know exactly what's going on, exactly how to help, and there's no problem for them at all. Everless for them. So don't be in a panic. If you want to sidestep the whole situation, just say, okay, it's full blast right now, but that's okay. Everything will be fine. No worries. I know there's help. And I won't feel all pulled down and guilt-ridden and all this kind of stuff. No, you'll feel happy. You'll feel happy. You're doing the right thing. Doing the right thing. Okay. Whew, and I'm making a lot of videos now, pumping this all out, because I don't know how much time I have here, really. Really don't. Because it's full blast now. I mean, any day, what could happen? Anything could happen any day right now. Because World War has actually started. It's on. So it's time to, the turnover times are here, and it's time for us to, the going gets tough, the tough get going. Actually, the really smart get going. Making their really smart decisions is what it's all about. And of course, everybody, my prayer is that everybody be really, really smart. Okay, I'm not threatened by everyone being really, really smart. Why should I be? It's only those who are dumbed down who are threatened by those who are really smart, because they're trying to make death real. I'm not trying to do the impossible, so I'm happy for everybody to be really, really smart, because you'll make smart decisions, and you'll be happy, and that'll make me happy. So it's a positive thing. Positive circle there. Be really, 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 really smart now. Okay, very great. That's it.